So last time I was here before my candidacy exam, now I'm going to present to you the work that I've done during my PhD that is related with two polyominoes. So first, I would like to start with this one. So all of polyominoes puzzles are related, or most of them are related to tiling. So I think that's why not everybody has studied the number of holes. So this is, I just want to mention, this is work with my advisor, Matthew Kale, and we work at this also at Guanajuato, Mexico. So how many holes does a typical polyomino have? So polyominoes are very difficult combinatorial structures, but they have very interesting topology, because most of with high probability, if you take out a polyomino, it's going to have a hole, at least when n tends to infinity. So if I am a magician and I can take out a polyomino that is randomly selected, how many holes am I going to see? So here you see a polyomino that has 50 tiles. It's almost uniformly random sampled, and you can see 4 holes. Okay, so we know that the expected number of holes grows linearly with the area. We have proved that. But I'm interested today to talk to you about the maximum number of holes. So if I give you n squares and I ask you to create a polyomino such that it's going to reach the maximum number of holes. So we conjecture that you only need one half, that you can reach one half n. And the best bound that is in the web or everything that we have church state of the art was 1/3. So this is a really good improvement. When Solomon Golomb defined it, was a simply connected figure, but we know that is no longer the case. So let me tell you about the asymptotic behavior of this function that is capturing the maximum number of holes that you can have. So the important thing here is that it is a sandwich to the maximum number of holes between 1/2 n, and you subtract some square root of n, that we're going to see the picture, and 1/2 n and some other square root of n. So when this goes to infinity, of course, and you divide by n, you're going to have 1/2. So with this, we have the corollary that you, on the long run, you will be able to create one hole per each 2 tiles. So how to prove this? It was a very interesting exercise. And there, we created sequences of polyominoes that reach the maximum number of holes. So in this pattern, you have 4 tiles and 2 holes. So with that, we're very happy because we're going to create 2 holes for every 4 tiles. So the way we created was like this. We add the other tiles to assure connectedness. So that is actually a polyomino. And then, well, there are some computations that one needs to do that I'm going to skip here. But you get the right bounds. And what about the gaps? Well, you start adding dominoes on the right or the left, I'm not sure. And then you will still have the same bound. Now, for exact values, this sequence that you see here reaches the maximum number of holes that you can create. And it has a fractal structure. So you start with 8 squares. You can create maximum number of holes is 1. You can see there one of them. And then you rotate 4 times, and you just take out the middle square. And then you do the same. So this has fractal properties. This has a fail. This has a line that is going to fill the square when you rescale. And so let me show you a big one. Here we also found an aperiodic tessellation that is behind this sequence of polyominoes. So you can see it is aperiodic because it has a middle point of rotation. It has the interesting property that it is a space-filling curve. We have not seen this aperiodic tiling. And of course, this sequence of polyominoes that reaches the maximum number of holes. So if you have any comments about it, I will appreciate talking to you about this research. And it is important to mention that for proving that this was actually reaching the exact number of polyominoes, we used an isoperimetric inequality. So yes, thank you very much.